monde d'être là aujourd'hui. On a encore une belle conférence devant nous et je suis très contente que notre conférencière d'aujourd'hui ait accepté mon invitation. Je vous présente ici Sarah Desmarais, qui est vice-présidente senior maintenant depuis peu, depuis cette année, chez Policy Research Associates Incorporated, qui est une compagnie qui fait beaucoup d'évaluation de programmes, de soutien à la formation, de conseils auprès des gouvernements et des politiques de santé et de comportement, donc au niveau de la justice et de l'itinérance, depuis plusieurs années maintenant, puis qui est très reconnue dans le monde de la recherche aussi pour la qualité de ses interventions. Ça fait donc plaisir de la recevoir aujourd'hui. Avant d'arriver chez PRA, Sarah était à North Carolina State University. Elle était professeure titulaire à NCS. Et elle a eu quand même des positions de leadership dans les dernières années en étant entre autres directrice du Center for Family and Community Engagement and Coordinator of the Applied Social and Community Psychology Graduate Program. Donc, Sarah a eu beaucoup d'influence jusqu'à maintenant dans l'orientation de plusieurs programmes d'intervention, de préjudiciarisation, d'évaluation de risque dans les milieux correctionnels, mais aussi dans les milieux communautaires. Elle a obtenu son doctorat en santé mentale forensique et droit de Simon Fraser University et un postdoc de UBC en Population and Public Health. C'est une chercheuse chevronnée dans le domaine et c'est une chercheuse aussi qui est très engagée auprès des différentes populations vulnérables, que ce soit en milieu carcéral ou dans la collectivité. Elle travaille donc à l'intersection de la santé mentale, de la justice, de la sécurité publique, l'itinérance, de la pauvreté. Et c'est avec grand plaisir qu'on l'accueille aujourd'hui et que je suis contente qu'elle va nous parler de toutes les questions de déjudiciarisation dans sa présentation. J'ai fait son introduction en français parce que je sais qu'elle comprend le français. Elle va donner sa conférence en anglais aujourd'hui, mais on verra après pour les questions. Alors, merci beaucoup, Sarah, d'être là. Et puis, it's all yours. Thank you.
Merci. Thank you so much. I am going to take a minute to share my screen and thank you for your patience as I do give my presentation in English. I wish I could in French, but maybe next year. So I really am excited to share just a couple highlights of two different projects that we've worked on over the last decade, really looking at mental health diversion. And I want to give just a bit of background. I think that most of us will be on the same page in terms of thinking about these issues, but I do want to also contextualize it in the reality that is doing this work in the United States. Then I'm going to touch on two projects. The first was a case study of a program in Miami-Dade, Florida, that we worked on for many, many years. And then I wanted to introduce a new project that we're starting to work on and really emerging science and legislation happening in real time in California. And then hopefully do all of that and leave plenty of time for questions and discussion. So I wanted to start by just situating the work and talking about why, for someone like myself who started working more in forensic psychiatric settings, in hospital settings, in jails and in prisons, why I was starting to be drawn into the work in the community. So we know in the US and elsewhere in Canada and abroad that adults with mental illnesses are really overrepresented in our jails. And in the US, the estimated rate of serious or severe mental illness like schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, et cetera, is somewhere in the neighborhood of 1 or 2% in the general population, but 25% or more in jails. And we know people with serious mental illnesses, while they're incarcerated, they lose those ties to the community. They really are starting to face much worsened treatment needs and their treatment needs are unmet. So I do want to just sort of state very clearly that in most jails in the United States, particularly the ones that I've worked in and the ones I'm going to talk about, people are not receiving mental health treatment, despite national federal legislation that this is a right that people have. We still are seeing the reality of it is that if people are not walking in the door, holding on to their prescription for their psychiatric meds, most often those jail service providers are unwilling to initiate new prescriptions, and often folks are really just not receiving any treatment in these jails. The other thing that we know is that when they're released into the community, and this is not just about the United States, but is exacerbated by some things that I'll talk about here, that we have folks who are fairly frequently homeless, housing instability, and limited access to services and other supports. So one thing that really factors into our work in a way that I never understood when I was working in Canada is that a lot of our people in jails in the United States are losing whatever insurance coverage they might have had once they walk in that jail door. So in the jails, the jail services that they might receive for mental health care are paid for under jail dollars. But when they're in the community, they might be receiving these services from Medicaid or Medicare, so federal dollars. And that's actually really important, because if they spend more than 30 to 60 days in jail, they no longer are enrolled in Medicaid and Medicare. And one of the things that happens is that if folks with serious mental illnesses are in jails, then they're being released, they've actually lost whatever insurance coverage they might have had. So then we're seeing, not surprisingly, very high rates of recidivism back through the criminal legal system and through acute care services. So we know that these sort of get tough policies are ineffective. We know that academically. I don't know if we totally know that in practice and in policy here in the US at least. But for a lot of reasons that we in psychology and other fields have been studying for 50 plus years, the way that our criminal justice systems are set up is not to give punishment in a way that it could be effective. We know this as early as, you know, Skinner and his rats. What would be successful strategies for behavior change are not what is being done kind of as a policy anyway in the criminal justice setting. So thankfully, in the US, where I would say a good couple of decades behind progress in Canada, but here in the US, there is a shift towards rehabilitation and towards alternatives to incarceration. And we're really seeing that pick up in the last decade or so. And I'm going to argue that mental health diversion programs are one of the possibilities for which we have a significant amount of buy-in from stakeholder groups, from community members all the way up through policy and decision makers. But also that we have a real opportunity to think about how do we keep people in care and out of the criminal justice system. So I wanted to provide the framework that we use here at Policy Research Associates, but also more generally when we're thinking about mental health diversion. So the SAMHSA Gaines Center, which is one of the centers that Policy Research Associates runs, is sort of known and really well sort of involved in this idea of identifying points in time in our criminal justice process that people could be identified and diverted. So some of you might be familiar with what's on the screen here. This is the sequential intercept model, which essentially breaks down any legal system contact for a person into intercepts 0 through 5. So 0 being before system involvement, 1 being local law enforcement, so police, sheriffs, and others. 2 being initial detention into jail and first appearance in court. 3 being specialty courts, so things like mental health courts, drug courts. In the US, we have veterans courts and other problem-solving courts. Jail, and in the US, it's important to know that in jail, we hold people who are pretrial, meaning that they are not yet found guilty, and they're awaiting their court date. We also hold people with lower sentences. So usually it's 18 months or less. So we have a mix of people in the jails that could be sentenced or pretrial. Then intercept 4 would be at the point of reentry from prison or jail. And then intercept 5 is what we consider to be community corrections in the US, and that would be probation and parole. And now it's not all usually this beautiful and linear, but I wanted to identify this as just the point at which male mental health jail diversion is happening most frequently in the US is intercepts 2 and 3. So what I'm gonna do is show you an example of intercept 2 and some of the work we did, and then an example of intercept 3. So here, another thing that I wanted to share is just a little bit of history around mental health jail diversion. We're really in a period of transformation and call for reform again in the United States. It seems to cycle. The last time we saw major reform was happening in the 60s. So as early as 1947, 1950s, there was a sentiment in the US, at least, that courts should be using some alternatives for prosecuting people and for dealing with people who, and in this case, it was starting with youth, who probably shouldn't be in the criminal legal system. Then in the 1960s, with all sorts of other civil rights movements, we saw several states, so Michigan, Connecticut, Illinois, and New York, passing laws authorizing treatment instead of prison or incarceration for some adults. And, you know, there were a lot of different ideas about what those categories of eligibility should be. But I think it's pretty notable that in the 60s, we were talking about the things that I'm going to be talking about today, you know, a good 60 years later. Move in through the 1960s, through the 80s, we saw legislation coming into play at a federal level about, for example, recommending diversion for drug offenses. Of course, that then took a hard turn in the 1980s when there was a war on crime here in the United States. And we then really began to criminalize offenses that in the 60s we had decriminalized. In the 1980s, we did see the emergence of a Pretrial Services Act, which established an idea of diversion, although pretty flawed. And then, you know, fast forward 30 years to 2010, and we had almost all of the states having some kind of diversion law or program in place, and that has just continued in the last decade. Now, what I think is interesting about giving this talk right now is that there's a real swing happening, pushing from civil rights organizations to move even further and further into decarceration in the United States. And then also a swing from the other direction, pushing further and further for reincarceration. So it's an interesting time to be doing this work. And I hope that the work that we're doing will help convince folks that decarceration is the solution and not the problem. But I suppose stay tuned on what actually happens at a federal or state level across the US. But I'm gonna show you some of the stuff that we're doing that is pushing the effort and that has gotten the attention at a federal level in terms of innovative approaches that could be effective in decarcerating and diverting individuals with mental health problems. So all that to say, there is really widespread implementation of mental health jail diversion programs in the United States, but the research isn't unanimously supportive of its effectiveness. So we don't always see decreases in recidivism. We don't always see good connection with community care. And we don't always see costs. So part of the real conversation here always, always is about who's paying for what. And I'm gonna get into that a little bit further, but people are very cranky when it becomes their responsibility in terms of who pays for that thing. And when I end with the California example, you'll see some creative and perhaps a little bit bizarre notions about how we pay for this. So enter our research group and the work that we've been doing for the last decade or so, really wanting to be conducting more rigorous research on effectiveness and also on the implementation, because my suspicion, anytime I see something that should work as an intervention, not achieve the outcomes that we expected, my first question is really, well, was it actually implemented the way it ought to be? And spoiler alert, what I'll tell you about the work in Miami is that we found out halfway through that it wasn't being implemented the way that we thought it would be implemented or that it ought to be implemented. So that is a lesson learned that we continue to learn every time we do this work. All right, so without further ado, I'm going to talk a little bit about the work we did with the Criminal Mental Health Project in Miami-Dade, Florida, which primarily is the city of Miami, Florida, and then some outlying suburbs. It is a huge county, and it is very often in the news in the United States. So in the early 2000s and since, the Miami-Dade County Jail has been under somewhere in the range of about 5 lawsuits by our federal Department of Justice for inhumane conditions and treatment of people with mental illnesses. That jail is the top right picture on your screen. And while it does look beautiful and Floridian and hot and warm and all things about Miami that draws people there, what you can't tell is that the ninth floor of that jail, which was built in the 1950s, has not been renovated since the 1950s. And they are housing at any given time, anywhere from 5 to 10 people with serious mental illnesses in cells that were designed for one person. So all that to say, there's a significant issue that continues to be addressed and improved, but nonetheless, still ongoing concerns. And again, this past year, they were facing challenges and as with many jails in the US and elsewhere around the spread of COVID-19. So the Miami-Dade jail houses anywhere from about 4 to 5 times as many adults with mental illness than there are being housed in hospitals in Florida. So Florida had the great idea to close most of its state hospitals as part of deinstitutionalization, but like many states in the US, they did not then open any community care settings. So people with serious mental illnesses end up cycling through the Miami-Dade County Jail dozens and dozens of times in the year. In the early 2000s, Judge Steve Lifeman really decided that he had had enough, that he was fed up, and that something needed to be done. And he just single-handedly really developed the Criminal Mental Health Project. He got funding from all sorts of places. And now, more than a decade or 2 decades later, they're serving 400 to 500 people per year, and they're getting ready to open a separate facility that will house as many people as the Miami-Dade County Jail, but it will all be for people with behavioral health needs. So the work that we were doing specifically was about getting people out of this jail. And we were focused on 3 of the 4 mental health diversion programs that they run. So post-booking misdemeanor, meaning low-level crime, post-booking felony, meaning higher, more severe, often violent crime. And then we also included folks from their post-booking forensic psychiatric hospital diversion program, but there were very few people from that program in our particular study. This is really a national model. It's been written up in infamous or famous places like the New England Medical Journal, just for being innovative in terms of how to try to solve the problem of mental illness in county jails in the United States. So here, this is what I would consider an Intercept 2 mental health jail diversion program. So despite a lot of success, there was still a continuation of a group of familiar faces who were cycling through the acute care and legal settings in this county. And where I got involved in the work was when my colleagues and I were invited to do an analysis of the familiar faces about a decade or so ago. And we were looking at identifying this group of 97 people, so about 97 clients, who over a 5-year period were responsible for 2,200 arrests, 27,000 jail days, 13,000 days in crisis or emergency acute care. And this dollar value is correct, and it is US dollars. So this group of 97 people cost about $13 million. So even though these 97 clients were 25% of the program referrals, they were only 5% of the total clientele being served. So overall, the Miami-Dade project, very successful in diverting folks and keeping them in community care and outside of the jail, with the exception of these more deep end familiar faces. So anchored in this work and in the risk need responsivity model, we said, well, what are the reasons why these folks keep coming back? Maybe they have more severe symptoms, maybe they need more support and access to services, and maybe they're presenting with more criminogenic risk factors. So we then said, well, we should provide more intense services, appoint someone to coordinate care, and we should try to target those needs. I'm not going to go into too much about the details of the research project, because I do want to be able to also give the case study on California, but suffice it to say, we did a randomized controlled trial, and we followed everybody up for 18 years with trying to select people who kind of met the criteria for these familiar faces. our three treatment groups were treatment as usual, care coordination, which is essentially having somebody help navigate all these different services they were supposed to be going through. And then we also added in a CBT program, cognitive behavioral therapy, with a focus on criminogenic needs. And we used a program out of Canada, Reasoning and Rehabilitation 2, developed by some folks at the Cognitive Science Center at Ottawa U. So we had some research questions that line up very much with the evidence that I was sharing around just how much folks were costing and why folks kept coming back to this particular program. We had 95 people randomized across conditions and 91 people in our sample. Ultimately, unfortunately, one participant passed away shortly after baseline, which sadly is not too uncommon in this work. And then also we had a few people who could not be matched in terms of their records. And you can see there, the sample looked very much like most of our samples that we're working with in these diversion programs in the US. Okay, so we had a bunch of different measures. We drew from semi-structured interviews, from various records. So the CMHP records are the program records that are maintained. That other big group of letters, SFBHN, is the service provider for that county, the oversight agency for that county. And then we tried to figure out recidivism, service use, and cost. We did it with a lot of fancy statistics that I'll be happy to talk about later, but I want to jump to what we found. So not surprisingly, redefining success, we did find that most folks came back to the program, not unexpected when we think about what this clientele looked like. But as we'll talk about, we did find some new definitions of success in terms of how long folks were staying out in the community and what really, you know, is a good outcome for people in mental health diversion. So I wanted to show you just very quickly what these things looked like. So TIU, treatment as usual, and then care coordination plus cognitive behavioral therapy. Overall, what we ended up finding over and over is that the mental health diversion program in its original form is very successful in doing the things it's supposed to do. And then care coordination and CBT added a little bit. So here we can see that we saw decreases for everyone in the number of arrests and that the number of arrests actually didn't differ between our treatment groups. We did see now more important decreases in jail days over time, and we did start to see some effect of the additional experimental conditions on outcomes. We also saw decreases here proportionately in the number of charges, and more specifically when we broke it down, the number of new charges. So a lot of people had pending charges given how many times they were coming in and out of the program already. We saw a significant increase in the number of outpatient services, which is a good thing, right? This means that more people that were in the experimental conditions were getting linked with care and actually showing up and getting services in the community. We found a decrease in the number of inpatient residential treatment days in our two experimental conditions. And then we also saw a significant decrease in the number of crisis services. So this would be services from the emergency rooms at hospitals or other what we call acute care settings here. So it could be like a crisis center that is separate from but akin to a hospital setting. This is where the numbers are going to maybe be a little shocking. So those numbers on the left, I just want to point out, are the average cost per client over the 18-month period of time. And those are indeed in tens of thousands in American dollars. However, we saw significant legal cost decreases. So even though they were getting arrested, they were still getting arrested and they were still coming back into the jail with new charges, they were not staying in jail as long, and each jail day represented a very significant cost savings. service costs increased somewhat, so that's to be expected. We saw some increase in costs associated with the fact they were now receiving more outpatient services. And we saw incredibly low program costs here. So the program costs really just reflected the salaries for the care coordinators and also just basic program administration. Overall, we saw cost savings across these different areas of cost that were very significant. And this was the real sell. The positive take-home message that we can share out with policymakers, with legislators, is that engaging in this work will actually save money. Now, not surprisingly, to some people aren't always happy when that cost savings represents a shift of costs to them. So even though there was a savings in the legal costs and an overall savings associated with the fact that they were incarcerated for less periods of time, that was a great kind of story to tell on the whole and to put out in press releases. You can imagine, though, that the increases in costs that then were being taken on by the service care providers, they were cranky, to say the least, about the fact that they now are experiencing a bit of a cost shift, even if the overall dollar amount is a savings. And remember, here in the US, we do not have universal healthcare. So these are often costs that aren't seen as overall costs. They're often seen as what is my cost that I am responsible for in my role, in my position. So overall, we found evidence that A, this program itself works, but that the care coordination and cognitive behavioral therapy did seem to have some small but added benefit in terms of recidivism and in terms of service utilization. But we also had a lot of lessons learned. So one of the things we realized is that we tried to find a provider that we felt could provide the CBT services and provide it with fidelity. We did that very successfully. However, we found it in an area that was very hard to get to. So ultimately, a lot of what was happening is that we were finding that the clients, some of them needed to take 2 to 3 buses to get to that particular service provider. And so we had very low attendance rates in those CBT groups. Even so, even when we had just 1 or 2 sessions of CBT, that seemed to have a protective effect. So, you know, overall, there are things to be considering, areas to work on, but my takeaway from this work is that mental health jail diversion and extra intense and matched services really do save money, first of all, but also confer a benefit for the individual. So that was very quickly, and I do want to just tell you a little bit about the next project that we're embarking on now. And this is a felony diversion program in the state of California. So I'm not sure how much you all have heard about this up in Canada, but we're actually experiencing a period of reinstitutionalization of forensic patients in the US. So in the last 20 years, really, we've seen a 75, almost 100% increase in the number of forensic patients in our state hospitals. So we still have, in many states, these large warehouse-type hospitals. In California, there are several hospitals, about 5 or 6, that have bed counts upwards of 1,500 to 1,800. So very large, old-school, traditional psychiatric hospitals. And state hospitals, just the language that is used because these are run by the state. So these are public institutions. In particular, in California, we've seen, as you can see, a dramatic increase in the number of patients and bed capacity for what is referred to as incompetent to stand trial. So these are individuals for whom either they're waiting evaluation or who they have been found incompetent or in Canadian language, unfit to stand trial. And those numbers are just remarkable from, you know, the last 5 years, from 271 to 1380, 426 to almost 1500 people. So what is happening? California is very progressive in many ways, and fortunately has a psychiatrist as the medical director of their Department of State Hospitals who believes that the hospital system is not the solution. So what they're looking at there is to really divert people that are on their wait list. So they're embarking on a jail, they've been doing it since 2018, trying to divert people who are on the wait list for hospital beds and into the community in lieu of coming into the hospital at all, and really trying to prevent further involvement with that particular court case that they're being held for. So focusing on individuals with schizophrenia spectrum disorder, trying to facilitate treatment access in the community, and also looking at whether or not we can focus on treatment on reducing risk as opposed to only increasing competence to stay on trial. So how are they doing this? Well, they, in 2018, the governor set aside $100 million for a three-year period, which we're just finishing now. And what's unique or strange or innovative about this is that California has an income tax on millionaires, and 1% of that income tax is what's funding this program. And I will tell you that is a very large pot of money, and California has just set aside another $400 million US to continue this program for 5 more years. To date, there are 24 counties in California participating. The thing that is attractive about it for counties is it's very flexible in the where and how they can spend the money. And the idea is that we're going to divert people post-booking. So here, this is now more along the lines of Intercept 3 in terms of thinking about diversion. People must have a schizophrenia spectrum disorder or bipolar disorder, be found IST, so incompetent to stand trial, or at risk on felony charges. So we're focusing specifically on people with more serious and often violent charges. They've specified that there has to be, based on a clinical evaluation, a relationship between mental disorder and the charged offense. So in other words, for these individuals, their mental illness must be criminogenic, and that they don't pose unreasonable danger to public safety. And if anyone is familiar with my work, you know that this is where I've spent a lot of the time in the last 3 years in terms of working with California. So what did they anticipate would be the potential impact? They estimated that of the 1,700 people currently on wait lists, 1,700 people in California in jails waiting to be transferred to hospital for an evaluation, they estimated that about half, 45%, would meet these diversion criteria. And they said, okay, well, we'll fund even more slots in the hopes that we can get all these people off the wait list. So 3 years later, where are we? We've had 400 plus people diverted, but only 11% of those were actually on the wait list. I can talk about what's going on for that. It's really about implementation at this point. What we're finding in terms of, this is a survey that we recently completed, just looking at barriers to service provision. The most common barrier that counties are saying is the reason they're not diverting people on the wait list and diverting other people instead is that the people on the wait list don't have the psychiatric stability, which in essence is really missing the point, because part of the point is that people will not be stable and can't be stabilized in hospital, so we should be diverting them to community care. Some other common responses were that there is concern about being unable to involuntarily medicate these individuals, which I don't think many of us agree is a solution to this issue or problem. There is disagreement at the local level about the criteria for diversion and what the definition of unreasonable danger to public safety is. And that relates then to another concern about recidivism. And they're honestly less concerned about the violent felony recidivism. They're really concerned about any recidivism right now. There's a lot of attention on diversion and community safety in the US, and almost any recidivism is being picked up in, or even if it's a new charge, not even a new conviction, there's just a lot of media attention and a lot of political reasons why it's being very challenging in counties. They're very scared to divert people. So where do we go from here? Well, I've been part of a statewide solutions work group to try to enhance adherence to diversion criteria. We're going to amend the criteria to make the mental disorder categories, the diagnostic eligibility broader. We're doing a lot of education with providers and decision makers, and we're also increasing oversight and accountability. We've heard anecdotally that there are counties that are using this because it is so flexible. They're using this program to divert people that don't necessarily meet criteria, but failed in other strategies. So for example, one county diverted somebody who failed out of drug court into this program, even though they didn't have a primary diagnosis of a serious mental illness. Where PRA is getting involved in the next year is that we're going to be launching a 5-year mixed methods evaluation. We're going to do process evaluation in all 24, soon to be 32 counties that are doing diversion. And then we're going to do an outcome evaluation using pre-post analyses in 8 counties, 2 large urban, 2 medium suburban, and 4 suburban rural. That is very quickly where we are, but I did want to make sure we had time to have any questions.